Are you right now at the verge of giving up on life? Do you battle condemnation and feel inadequate? Is there a part of you that doubts whether God truly loves you? Would you like to better comprehend God's love for you? Life is full of uncertainties, but in God, there is an assurance of a beautiful future. Be inspired as you receive God's word that will stir up faith and confidence in the love that God has for you. Join us today on The Covenant Light.
God provides.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
So why do I worry about my
good.
When
morning,
you come to my rescue,
everyone,
a thousand times.
Of our America,
every
Canada, North and South America,
God provides,
Covenant Light Outreach.
God provides.
I celebrate you all.
In
go
ways
ahead.
I can't explain and
send
can't
out these
deny.
Links to as many people as you can.
The little that
then join
I
me at the chat section. Say good morning.
Just when
let me know
I
you're online. Tell me your name
on time.
And where you are joining in from.
God provides. He'll come through when the clouds of doubt rain down on you.
Hallelujah.
And
Pastor
Essien,
I see you.
You knew.
And I celebrate you.
Now you finally see what God
Hallelujah.
Can do.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
For you. So
let's reach out to everyone
close
on
your eyes,
the America's
no
group. Send them a chat
fight.
One by one. And let's have them all on board.
Watch God provide.
Tonight, if you're online, send as well to all the
God provides
to the central group.
It's
Covenant
hard
Light
to
Breakthrough
say
Hour.
When there's no food to
if anyone
eat.
Missed the earlier
oh,
meeting?
God, I only want what you believe for me. So tonight, close your eyes. There's no more need to fight. Watch God provide.
Yeah.
He will provide. Before your eyes. Oh, He will.
So tonight,
close your eyes. There's no more need to.
Okay, is it still breaking? Have I just said it? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Watch God provide. Glory to God. All right. If you're out there, if you're joining in, feel free to go to the, encourage you to go to the chat section, type in your name and let me know where you're joining in from. So far I have Pastor Essien and Turaya online. Hallelujah. All right. Go ahead and just begin to worship him wherever you are and bless the Lord with all your heart. Glory to God. Bless him, bless him, bless him. We are going to go forward into... Okay, Stephanie from Nairobi is joined in as well. We're going to give her a few more minutes, about 3 more minutes. to let more people join in. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We're going to go into the breaking of bread. Glory to God. And we're beginning immediately. We're going to be, first of all, praying, beginning with the breaking of bread this morning. We're going to be breaking bread and praying this morning. And the Bible tells us in the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 11 about the breaking of bread. It says, when we break bread, if you start from verse 23 to 26, it says, when we break bread, we proclaim the Lord's death. That's what breaking of bread is. You always know powerful things by what the devil is fighting. Whatever the devil is fighting is what God has placed power in. When Jesus was born, the devil came against Jesus. Everything was going wrong. No room in the inn. A pregnant woman had to travel many kilometers, in which she had to several locations track. It was an arduous journey. And she had to travel because she was carrying a glorious thing. So you always know what is powerful, but what the devil is against. And there are a lot of people who have come against two things very particularly in our time: the tithe, and the breaking of bread. Oh, you know, we no longer need to break bread. But you find out that before the law, when Abraham faced Melchizedek, it was the two things. Melchizedek brought bread and wine. Abraham brought the tithe. Melchizedek brought bread and wine. Abraham brought the tithe. And these were people who Abraham already received the promises. And so this morning we're bringing the bread and the wine. And the Bible tells us its significance in 1 Corinthians 11 and verse 26. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So it's not the bread or the cup, but what it signifies. It's not a charm. You know, you don't treat it like a charm. Or you put it in one, you know, you take the wine after it has been blessed. You put it in one container somewhere, sprinkle it in your house, touch it on your eye, you know, use it, place it over a wound, place it over your hand so that it can be healed. No, it's not a charm. It is the power of the breaking of bread, the Lord's Supper, it's the significance of it. What you are doing in the spirit when you take it. That's why it doesn't matter whether it is bread or biscuit, whether it is water or coke, whether it is a soup you used or ugali you used for bread, doesn't matter. Or whether it is chapati that you use for bread, doesn't matter, because it's the significance of it. The significance of it is that you are proclaiming the Lord's death. You are saying in the name of Jesus, I am announcing. That word proclaim means to show. The King James Version says you are showing the Lord's death. Means to show something. So when you break bread, do it as often. Look at that statement. As often as you do this, do it as often as you can. We are committing to do this daily, Monday to Friday. And when you show something, you are asking everyone to treat you a particular way. Showing what it means. If you show your certificate from school, nobody was there when you were doing your 5-year study. Your boss was not there. The company trying to employ you was not there. But the moment you show your certificate, they treat you as a graduate. They treat you as a graduate. They change in the way they react to you and relate with you. A person, a pervert, is walking down the road, clothed. Nobody treats him like a pervert. Then he shows his nakedness. He flashes someone, takes off his clothes and shows people his nakedness. Now, everybody treats him a particular way because of what he showed them. When you break bread in the spirit, you are showing, proclaiming to hell, to heaven, to earth, the Lord's death. And what does that mean for you? What does that mean for you? Here is what it means, child of God. You know, I came across this scripture, so powerful, so powerful. Isaiah chapter 40. If you will put this scripture somewhere where you can see it regularly, it's beautiful. Isaiah 40 verse 1 to 2, it says, comfort, comfort, yes, comfort my people, says your God. Speak comfort to Jerusalem and cry out to her. Watch what preaching in our time is supposed to be about. What are we supposed to cry out to God's people? He says that her warfare is ended. Somebody shout hallelujah. Her fighting is over. We're no longer at war. We're no longer fighting the enemy in the sense of there's still warfare between. Jesus ended that. Why is her warfare ended? That her iniquity is pardoned. That's what the sacrifice, that's what the death of Jesus means. When you are showing and proclaiming the Lord's death, because by his sacrifice, by his death, he has ended the war. By his death, your iniquity is pardoned. So you are announcing to all of heaven and announcing to all of hell and announcing to all the earth, my iniquity is pardoned, so there is no basis for attack anymore against my life. Why? Why is her warfare ended? And our iniquity pardoned. It wasn't just sporadic. It wasn't just a decision God made to pardon. There was a price paid. Look at the next statement. For she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. She has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. In other words, God is saying you have been punished double already. You've been punished more than the sins. Glory to God. When were you punished? In Christ Jesus. In Christ Jesus. You were punished in Christ Jesus for the sins. And so when you are announcing the Lord's death, you are saying, I've been punished already for my sins. So my iniquity is pardoned and this attack against me, this warfare is over. Hallelujah. Let's take the bread and wine now. Father, in the name, say with me, say, Father, in Jesus' name, my iniquity is pardoned. My warfare is ended. Every attack against me, against my health, against my finances, against my spiritual life, against my spiritual growth, against my walking in holiness, every attack against me in any area of my life, against my family, against my marital life, in the name of Jesus, it is ended. It is ended. As I proclaim the Lord's death, I command every attack to cease. I command every manifestation of punishment for sins in my life to cease. For I have already been punished double for every sin in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Go ahead and take it. And believe God. Hallelujah. Go ahead wherever you are. Begin to rejoice and bless the Lord. Begin to rejoice and bless the Lord. Praise Him. Hallelujah. Type it in there. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Blessed be His holy name. Oh, paramashante rebogos kerianande. Stis labokos glianumbra kateliamande. Oh, rabashante liabramakos elianande. Rebos keribas kanteria balamahash ketelia. We're going to go straight into the time of prayer. And here's this. Yesterday, we received the word from God. We prayed about certain things. And this morning, we are going to establish ourselves in those things. And why is that? Isaiah chapter 55. The same book of Isaiah chapter 55. You know, you've got to learn to pray with the word of God. From verse 10, it says, "For as the rain comes down from heaven, and the snow, and does not return there, but water the earth, and make it bring forth and bud, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and shall prosper in the thing that I sent it." God is saying, the way that rain comes from heaven and does not go back without accomplishing what it was sent to do, which is to make the earth bring forth and bud and give seed to the sower and bread to the eater. So that's how my word works. When you receive my word, when you receive a prophetic word, when you receive a word from God, He said, that word will not return to me void. It won't come back to God without accomplishing what he pleases, what He sent it to do. And what was it? It says, "For you shall go out with joy," verse 12, "and be led out with peace. The mountains and the hills shall break forth into singing before you, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands." So the word of God, when He speaks to us, it will not return to Him void. Well, yesterday, for those who may be joining us for the first time today, yesterday the Lord spoke to us. He said, this year will be a year of profit. He said, you will experience returns this year And there will be no more loss. There will be no more investments that are unyielding. There will be restoration of double for every trouble. God spoke to us from three scriptures, Proverbs 14 and verse 23. Proverbs 14 and verse 23. You just speak in tongues where you are, because I want us to do this right. Proverbs 14 and verse 23. In all labor there is profit. God said to us, in all labor there is profit. So your labor will no longer be without profit. All of your investments and labor spiritually, financially, in the skills, in your career, and academically, the places, it said maritally, financially, academically, career-wise, health, spiritual, all of these areas that you've poured in resources in your children and family. You have poured in, and then at the end of the day, it was all for nothing. No, here's the promise of God. In all labor, there is profit. In all labor, there is profit. The Lord also said to us in Isaiah 48 and verse 17. Thus says the Lord your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, I am the Lord your God who teaches you to profit, who leads you by the way you should go. So yesterday we prayed and we asked God to guide us this year, the remaining part of this year, to profit. No wasted effort, no wasted labor, no wasted investments. And then in Zechariah 9 and verse 12, he said, I will give you double for every trouble. And so this morning, as I stood before God, before our time of prayer this morning, I stood before the Lord and I said, Lord, what's the direction this morning? He quoted that Isaiah 55 to me. He said, my people should return to me with the words I've spoken to them. And I want them to praise me. Praise me. Praise me. Hallelujah. I want them to praise me for what they have received. So today we are going to strengthen our faith in that word. It's sometimes you receive a word and you move on. But God said, no, my word this week is that you will, by the end of this year, you will look back and say, I have received returns on all my investments. My investments in my children, my investments in my family, my investments in my business, my investments in my spiritual life, my investments in my health, my investments in my finances, my investments in my career. He said, you will say, I have received returns on all of them. There was no wasted investment. There was no loss. The key word God gave us yesterday was no more loss. Somebody say no more loss. Somebody say no more loss. Somebody say it boldly. Say no more loss in the name of Jesus Christ. No more loss. No more wasted investments. No more wasted efforts. Wasted labor. No more in vain labor. In vain efforts. In vain. No more. And this morning, we are going to return those words to God. You see, Isaiah said, his words will not return to him void. How does God's word return to him? From your own lips. When you are saying those words back to God, when you say, God, you said to me that there will be no more loss, that I will have double for the trouble. So even the loss of the past, I will be restored double. You said you will direct me into profit. You said in your word that in all labor there is profit. So when you are saying that, what are you doing? You are returning, not your own words. He said it. So you are returning his words to him. He said, my words will not return to me void. So when you're returning God's word to him, it has to accomplish what he said to do in your life. It has to accomplish what he was sent to do, because it will not return void, and you are returning it to him. If you get that, say, I get it. Hallelujah. I get it. So when you return God's word to him, how do you do that? In prayer and in praise. One last verse of scripture, and we begin to pray. In Romans chapter 4. The Bible says, talking about Abraham, it says from verse 16, therefore it is of faith that it might be according to grace, so that the promise might be sure to all the seed, not only to those who are of the law, but also to those who are of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made you a father of many nations, in the presence of him whom he believed, God, who gives life to the dead and calls those things that be not as though they exist, who contrary to hope, in hope believed. Talking about Abraham. So that he became the father of many nations. Contrary to hope. When it was not expected that he should be believing such, he believed it. It was against normal. It was more than what he could see. It was not what he was seeing around him, but he chose to believe. All right. Verse 19. And not being weak in faith, he did not consider his own body already dead, since he was about 100 years old, and the deadness of Sarah's womb. Now, this is where we're going, verse 20. He did not waver at the promises of God through unbelief, but was strengthened in faith, giving glory to God. Was strengthened in faith, giving glory to God. How was he strengthened in faith? How did Abraham stay in faith? Look at the two things he did. He was strengthened in faith, giving glory to God, and being fully convinced that what he had promised, he was also able to perform. That was why he was strong in faith, giving glory to God. And that's what we're doing this morning. You are going to be standing in that faith. No more loss. No more loss. Somebody say it again. Say, no more loss. Somebody type it in there with faith in your heart. Say, no more loss. No more loss. I will not lose out. All my efforts and labor are yielding abundantly for me in the name of Jesus Christ. My efforts and labor are yielding abundantly for me in the name of Jesus. You're standing in that faith, how? Giving glory to God and being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was able also to perform. Lift your hands wherever you are. Lift your hands to him. Now say with me, say, Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, I come before you and I receive your word that this year there will be no more loss, that before this year is over, I will profit. I come before you fully convinced of your word in Proverbs 14 and verse 23, that in all labor there is profit. And so today, concerning my marital life, financial life, my academics, my career, my health, my spiritual life, my family, I boldly declare, no more loss. I will not labor in vain, but my labors are yielding abundantly for me. And I prosper in the things that I set my hands to, in the name of Jesus Christ. Because it's your word, I come before you. I give you glory and I praise you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I am convinced that you are able to perform what you have promised. I give you the glory. I give you the honor that what you have done in the cross, you are fulfilling in me. In the name of Jesus, lift your hands wherever you are. Begin to praise him in your own way. Begin to praise him in your own way. Glory to God. Begin to praise him in your own way. Praise him specifically now for the things. Now make it specific. What's that area of your life where the devil is saying to you, you will suffer loss? For Abraham, it was that he would not have children. He was 100 years old and no child. But he had a word from God. And the Bible said he wavered not. He wavered not at God's promises through unbelief, but was strong in faith. How? Giving glory to God and being fully convinced that what he had promised he was able also to do. Lift your voice to him. Lift your voice to him. Marabo socoro bronon de geliana hake, pasha tabayaka bora mashande, reboko se tereboko seriba gashatalia, licrande gevesula mash caladia, masondre gesida bora makezolo brate, rekezo pramande gesheniga maya, malienondre gesiza bala makora brahashke, reketozolo brogoduso frenonde, ricamondo roboshke redia. Now give him praise. Give him praise and begin to speak in other tongues. Begin to speak in other tongues. This morning, it's praise service. Hallelujah. Give him praise and begin to speak in other tongues. Mandeli para makoskera brayate kelenosa. Eronondre gesila makande lebosha. Rimande geledia geredosa fradita kaliama. Elekronde gesila mondo roboshke. Trelo monderia bokora mahaske, mareboshke ranande geselia nande, stizobra galistopra galiaman koroboshke teliamande, reboskora nande gesidi bala mahaya, makebenondre gesheila brakatoze liamande, lemos velediga valamantre gesuso. Father, we give you praise. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Ikanemoros kombredia. Bible says when you speak in other tongues, you are giving God thanks well. Bible says, thou verily givest thanks well. You can give thanks praying in the spirit. Hallelujah. You can give thanks praying in the spirit. Ikamonde diabokoske renande. Isto jebrak dele makora baaktelia. Membra gelenondre gesidia galamande. Rekokora fratika ragele bosha. Retora brakalandre gedusko renande. Rimaso frenonda galia nahaske. Lehekora fraketozilia para babarama akola akrenonde nakelia mongra bole moshkera ninda erebrendo goskentra galamando roboshkera di androx tola max te gela gracte pronondre geledia nekelia mandre gesokoro brogoshikalamande nehekora branande gesitia balamahaya nekora pratiga le monde geleniso makele vrononde gredisha. Bless God in the spirit right now. Oh, hallelujah. 1 Corinthians chapter 14. The Bible says, otherwise, if you bless with the spirit, how will he who occupies the place of the uninformed say amen at your giving of thanks? So you can bless in the spirit. When you are not praying for someone else, you're praying about yourself. You're not praying for someone else to hear you, just you and God. Well, you can bless in the spirit. You can bless with the spirit. And you give thanks well. Verse 17 says, For you indeed give thanks well. Perfect thanks is done in the spirit. Open your mouth and lift your hand to heaven with a heart assured, fully persuaded that what he has promised is able also to do, fully persuaded that God has brought forth what he has said in your life. Lift your hands to heaven and give him praise. Give him praise. Are you a preacher of the gospel? Are you a pastor? That church is multiplying in the name of Jesus. I feel an anointing of the Spirit of God to speak. Are you a leader? That thing you are leading is growing in the name of Jesus. Are you a mother? That your effort towards your family and children are yielding results in the name of Jesus. Are you a sower of seeds? I decree and declare in the name of Jesus. Your seeds are multiplied to you, and you have bread for food and more seed to sow in the name of Jesus. Whatever you are, wherever your efforts have been directed, There is result. There is profiting. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. There will be no mockery. There will be no mockery. There will be no mockery. You will not have reason to be ashamed. Those that saw you bearing your sheaves, going to bearing your seeds and going to sow, shall doubtless see you return with your harvest. In the name of Jesus, they will see you return with your harvest. Those who saw you sow will see you reap. Those who saw you give will see you receive. Those who saw you labor will see you rejoice in the fruit of your labor. In the name of Jesus. Mayake bora mashandelia. Keep praising him, child of God. The anointing of the Holy Spirit is resting on me right now. And I decree in Jesus' name, those who saw you labor will see you with the reward and the result of your labor. Those who saw you sleepless at night, reading and studying because of an exam, they will see you rejoicing at the results of that exam. Those who saw you search will see you find. Those who saw you pray will see you in the name of Jesus with the reward and the result of your prayer. Those who saw you labor will see you with your reward. In the name of Jesus. It's at Market Prodi. I'm seeing in my spirit. I'm seeing 10:59, 11:59, 12:59, 13:59, 14:59. And I'm saying in my spirit just now, Lord, what is that? He said, it's about time. Glory to God. Oh, hallelujah. It's 1 minute to time. I'm here to announce to someone by the power of the Holy Spirit and in the name of Jesus that the hour has come. It's 10:59 because 11 is here. It's 12:59 because 1 o'clock in the afternoon is here. Glory to God. God is saying to you, child of God, the hour has come. You know, when you're watching that clock and you see 11:59 and you're meant to do something at 12, you're waiting. I feel such an anointing this morning. You're waiting. There's something about praise. You're waiting. And you're ready. You're adjusting your shirt because you're about to, at exactly 12 o'clock, the camera will come on. And you will have to address something, and you're adjusting your shirt, you're adjusting your tie, you're looking at final touch-up of your face, look at the mirror, and you're waiting. And the person begins to count down. And 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, it's still reading 11:59, 3, 2, and bam, it's 12 o'clock, it begins. I just saw in my spirit that those figures, 10:59, 11:59, 12:59, 13:59. And God said to tell someone, the hour has come. Make your final preparations. Touch up. He will reap in due season if he faints not, the Bible says. Be not weary in well-doing. Be not weary in the labor. Because you will reap in due season if you faint not. See that due season? That's what 11:59 is about. Your due season has come. Your due season is here. Your due season is here. Lift your hands wherever you are. Give him praise. 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 Whatever it is for you, due season for marriage. Due season for marriage. I say it again. Due season for marriage. Oh, Maria Bala, due season to have children. Due season to go forth in the power of the Holy Spirit and plant that church. Due season to break that habit that you've been struggling with. Due season for the harvest of seed sown. Your due season is here. Your due season is here. Glory be to God. Glory be to Jesus. Hallelujah. Give him praise, somebody. Give him praise. Father, we thank you. We bless and praise and exalt you in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Blessed be your holy name forever. Lift your hand, somebody. You see, your thanks and your hallelujah should not be less than other things. So sending that, typing that, say it out. Glory to God, hallelujah, praise God, whatever. It should not be less. Give him praise. Give him praise. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. And that's what we're going to be doing. We're coming that we, God has spoken. We will dance and celebrate it and receive more. We're coming again that we, God has spoken. We will dance and celebrate it and we receive more. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Blessed be your holy name forever. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Father, in the name of Jesus, let's get into the word briefly before we close. We ask you for revelation knowledge to dawn upon our hearts as we look into your word. Let words and thoughts from heaven flow freely through me to your people. Let these words and thoughts continue to speak to us beyond this moment. And Father, I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that signs and wonders be done in the lives of everyone under the sound of my voice. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Let's get into. The Lord spoke to us. God told me, he said he wants to bring his people into a place of financial prosperity, supernatural prosperity. We titled this 1,000 times more. Supernatural prosperity. Somebody say, supernatural prosperity is mine. Say it. Say, supernatural prosperity is mine. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And there is a reason why this is supernatural prosperity. Because there is a natural prosperity, and we see it all over the place. When you look around you, the prosperous, there are a lot of prosperous people that have finances that are not believers. So we know that there is a natural prosperity. But the Bible says about that natural prosperity, he says that it is uncertain riches. The Bible calls it uncertain riches. In Timothy chapter 6 verse 17, 1 Timothy, it says, charge them that are rich in this world not to trust in uncertain riches. They are rich in this world. That's natural wealth. Not to trust in uncertain riches. In fact, let's turn our Bibles there and take off from there this morning. First Timothy chapter 6 and verse 17. The New American Standard Bible says, instruct those who are rich in this present world not to be conceited or to fix their hope on the uncertainty of riches, but on God who richly supplies us with all things to enjoy. Then verse 18, it says, instruct them to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, storing up for themselves. Storing up. You see, certainty is because there's something stored up. But it's not stored up here. It's stored up spiritually. Storing up for themselves the treasure of good foundation for the future. So it's not uncertain again. All right. But what changed it from uncertain riches to certain riches? To something that has a good foundation for the future. That no matter what happens in the future, it's no longer dependent on what happens in the natural. There are a lot of people today, if there's an economic downturn and banks are closed or something, they are stuck. They're in trouble. Because everything is about here. But there are some of us who have learned to turn from uncertain riches to certain riches. So we still have wealth, but they are not uncertain. Because they are not anchored on men and their promises, or flesh and the arm of flesh. They are anchored on, look at what he told them to do. He said, instruct them to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share. So this place of good works is our focus this season. God said to us, first instruction is embrace your good works. Embrace your good works. Discover and embrace your good works. And we looked at several scriptures in the light of that. We looked at 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 8. The Bible says, God is able to make all grace abound towards you, so that you, having all sufficiency in all things, will abound to every good work. So God wants you to abound to good works. Remember, he said to those who are rich in this world, focus on the good works. Okay, focus on good works. And he tells all of us, in case somebody says, well, I'm not rich, so he's not talking to me. He says, no, even if you don't have resources right now, God is able to make you have the resources so that you can abound to good work. So when you're talking about supernatural prosperity, the way it happens is somebody embraces the good works and God begins to supply, because he wants to get resources into those good works. Somebody embraces the good works. It's like deploying to site. The government says, we want to build a bridge that goes all the way from Africa to the U.S., a bridge across the Atlantic Ocean, assuming that were humanly possible, and the technology is there. Everybody starts bidding. It's a good work. Everybody starts bidding. It's a beneficial. That word good means beneficial work. Work that benefits people. Everybody starts bidding for it. Julius Berger bids, and RCCB, this company, that company. And then it is awarded to one of them, Julius Berger. And the whole of Julius Berger, they are all screaming and shouting. Why are they shouting? They are shouting because they know they're about to get money. They know they're about to get billions. They know they're about to get trillions if you're going to build across an ocean of dollars. They are rejoicing. They are rejoicing. There's about to be some serious labor, but they are dancing. Are they dancing just because they are going to be working? No, they are dancing because they know that whichever government awarded that contract, or nations that came together and awarded that contract, are going to pay them. So God says, I'm awarding contracts. And anyone who receives my contract, I will pay them to start. I don't ask you to do it, then I pay you. No, I give you some upfront. Because your heart is to build and do that my contract. So what's the contract? What is that contract? We looked at that. The Bible says it's the ministry of reconciliation. 2 Corinthians 5 verse 18. That God has called us, all of us, to the ministry of reconciling people to himself. That is the contract. God got us saved. 2 Corinthians 5 verse 17. If any man is in Christ, he's a new creation. All things have passed away. All things have become new. God brought us to salvation, changed us. Our old things have passed away. All things have become new. And in verse 18, he says, and now he has given to you and I the ministry, the contract, to reconcile other people to him. Now, many have not embraced that contract. Embracing that contract is what God pays for. And God is not like governments who are easily deceived and cheated, nor does he cheat. He's not like your regular government that will ask you to go work and then they won't pay because somebody is looking for kickback. That will ask you, or that you will go and not work and then you say, where's the pay? He says, no, there's a contract. I can help give you food to eat and all that because you're in your father's house. The birds don't have to work. You don't have to work for me to have food to eat and a place to sleep. Anyone who just trusts God, God will give you a place to sleep. That's not what we're talking about here. Your needs being met is not what we're talking about. That is not prosperity. Needs being met is not prosperity. Prosperity is having more than enough. All right? More than your needs being met. So remember 2 Corinthians 9 verse 8. God is able to make all grace abound towards you, so that you having all sufficiency in all things will abound. See, that's more than enough to every good work. So God is not the God you will say, oh God, just don't worry, send me all the money. No, he tells you, deploy. Be about this work I've given you, and I will supply the resources. So we know it's the ministry of reconciliation. We know it is the work of men being turned to God. We know that. The Bible is very explicit about that. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 14, the Bible says, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven. Oh, so these good works is meant to be something that people will encounter and turn towards God. Can you see that? It's what it means to shine your light. Your light is not just singing about this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Or singing about shine, shine, shine. Oh, light, shine, shine, shine. No. You don't sing light into shining. No. How do you let your light shine? Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works. So how you shine your light is doing these good works that people are turned towards God. We're going to, you know, like I told you, we're going to come to practical things. I'm a very practical teacher, if you know me. So, but I'm building up the foundation for the things I want to say to you. So when we start discussing those practical good works, you will connect them with the scripture, and it will not be man's opinion. But as I was speaking now, God said to tell someone, I actually know the person. I just saw the person's face in my spirit and the name of the person, but I won't call the person out. God said, you're a singer. God said to tell you, do not be focused on financing yourself now that you forget the assignment, the good work. Do not go for the highest pay. Do not go for the immediate pay. He said, follow your heart. Follow your heart. All right? Glory to God. Follow your heart. All right. So there it is. Your good works must be flowing out of you. The good works is not something on the side. And that is the issue that the Spirit of God wants to address this morning. If you want supernatural prosperity, your good works cannot be on the side. Your good works, as we describe what it is, cannot be something for like it is for most Christians today. Something haphazard. Something from time to time when they're in a situation that they feel obligated to maybe demonstrate God's love to someone, maybe help someone out. They do it because, well, you see, I'm a Christian, you know, and then it's once in a while, it's once in a month, and it's as the situation, you know, arises, you know, maybe they are somewhere and somebody just faints. Well, they give him some water and they leave there like, yeah, I've done some good work today. No, Bible says you were ordained for it. Ephesians 2 verse 10, the Bible says we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus unto good works. Do you understand what that means? I'm sitting on a chair right now as I'm talking to you. If you were to be around me in my office here, you would see me on a chair. The chair was created for sitting. So the chair being sat on is not from time to time. The chair is wired, configured for sitting. So a chair would have many times people sitting on it. The Bible is saying you were wired for good works. God designed you so that you can be doing good. And in doing good, you have prosperity that is on a sure foundation or footing. God wired you for good works. And so good works, the same way the chair cannot from time to time. Your phone is designed for communication. It doesn't communicate from time to time. No, it's what, if somebody wants to reach you, it's through that phone. If you want to reach someone, it's through that phone. Well, you are the phone for good works. You are the chair for good works. And if God wants to touch lives around you, it's through you. If God wants to bless lives around you, it's through you. So what is this good work? What is the good work? It is getting people to salvation. But how do we go about it? God's plan, when you understand it, is that you will bless people around you. If you want to do the good works the way Jesus did it, let me show you Jesus' own style. Bible says in Acts chapter 10, verse 38, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth, who went about. If you didn't know that scripture before, you would, when you think of Jesus and what he went about doing, you would say, who went about preaching? But that's not what the Bible says. You will say, who went about teaching? That's not what the Bible says. The Bible says how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth, who went about doing good and healing all that were oppressed. So you want to do the Jesus way, where the ministry of reconciliation is concerned? Go about doing good, like a ministry. Go about doing good. You know, we need to say it as it is. How many good did you do yesterday? How many good did you do? Who did you embarrass yesterday with goodness? Who did you embarrass? Think about that with me. This is what a chair is to sit in. What a phone is to communicating. What TikTok is to making a fool of yourself. That is what you are to doing good. So what good did you do yesterday? Let me read you some scriptures. Galatians 6 verse 10. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good. 1 Timothy 6 verse 18. I just read to you. Let them do good. Talking about the rich. Hebrews 13, 16. Do not forget to do good. James 4, 17. To him that knows to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. I could go on and on. It's all through scripture. We are encouraged to now deliberately be looking for. Everywhere you're going, you're looking for. Because God has planted you as light in darkness. So darkness is all around you. People going through stuff. People needing help. People needing prayer. People needing someone to just hold them. You know, yesterday I was with a lady. And she, you know, I went to the mall and I met her. She's someone I had known before. And when I first came, when I first came to Nairobi. So I met her and I said, you know, what's up? She said, I need to talk to you. Thank God, I need to talk to you. I said, come over. So she came. And she was telling me what has happened since the last time we saw. She said, I'm broken and all of that. You know, and basically it was every guy who has loved her just used her. Every guy who has pretended to love her, rather say, just used her. And she said, I was thinking who to reach out to. And the only person who has ever shown me love and did not take advantage of me was you. And I wanted to talk to you. And she told me everything that was going on with guys. And I just told her, I said, well, you're looking for love in all the wrong places. You know, I just ministered to her. And then right there, I just put my hand around her and I held her. And she cried and all of that. And then she was okay. And I left. I wasn't spooky. I didn't try to like over spiritualize it. I just blessed her. And when she left, you know, I paid the Uber for her to come to where I was. I paid the Uber for her to go back. And then when she left on her way, as she was going, she sent a chat. And she said, you know, thank you so much. I would like to have further conversations about this in due time. I said, I'm here. Now, somewhere down the road, I'm going to cash that in for God. You know, but she knows who I am. She knows what I stand for. She don't do these things in isolation. She's glorifying God for the good. Now, I use that example for a reason. It's just one of the things that happened yesterday. And people think, oh, well, you are a pastor. That's what you're supposed to be doing. No, that's what we are all supposed to be doing. The job of a pastor, an evangelist, an apostle, and all that is not just to do these things. Bible calls them the coaches. They are to provoke these things in us. Bible says they have been given us to train us to do good, to train us for the work of ministry, the work of ministry. Ephesians 4 tells us that most of you listening to me know those scriptures. It says God has given us evangelists, pastor, apostle, prophet, teacher for the edifying of the saints for the work of ministry, building the saints up so that the saints can do the work of the ministry of reconciliation, the good work, the things required to be done so that the ministry of reconciliation can happen. So you are meant to be doing this. You need to go through every day and say, how many good did I do today? Who did I touch today? Who wept on my shoulder today? Who cried and said, you know, I need to turn back to God? I came back to Nairobi, and I'm not boasting on myself, but I'm trying to show how this can be a pattern of life. I came back to Nairobi just about a week or so ago, a week and a half ago. You know, and I can tell you in numbers that are not single digits, people that I have had either communication, sorted something out, advised, gave, people who would say, if I call them now and say, you know what, come gather, I want to talk to you, they would be where I am immediately because they feel a sense of owing me. That's really the idea of the good works. When you start doing them, people start feeling like they owe you. And you turn all of that to God. Now they go towards God. Now they are coming to church. Now they are hearing the word. Now they are joining in the devotions. One of the people that the first person I ministered to when I came, I want to stop using phrases like minister, so forgive me for that, because that makes a lot of people feel like it's not about me. I'm not a minister. Pastor is a minister, so he ministers to people. No, he's just doing good. One of the first people that when I came in, even before I came in, I said, come, she told me some things were happening. I said, come see me. This was a chat she sent. She said, I listened to the word today. And I said, oh, really? How do you mean listen to the word? She said, well, I joined the CBH, the group. She didn't know what it said, the group where they post those messages. Those things in the morning. He said, I've joined it since. He said, now I listened to yesterday. You see, it's not forced. I would have told her to listen to it, but I didn't think I had gotten to where I would insist that she listen, because I normally build gradually towards it. I didn't think I had gotten there, but she was there already. She said, I listened yesterday to the word. And hopefully today as well, she's listening. And I celebrate you, my daughter. If you're listening to me right now. So, God has called us to this. You want to prosper supernaturally? Don't make what God makes a central issue. Don't make it a side issue. What God says is wife, don't make a side chick. What God says is the main thing. Don't make a side thing. God says the good works is the main thing. You need to bless people. Bless people till they are saying, hey, what can I do for you? You say, why don't you give me 5 minutes to share the gospel with you? All right, we're going to stop there today. Hallelujah. And continue tomorrow. Glory be to God. Did this bless you? If it blessed you, let me know it blessed you. Say, it blessed me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Give God praise. Lift your hands wherever you are, giving praise for his word. Glory be to Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I want to first of all pray for those who today, now while I'm praying for you, they will post some links that I'm going to talk to you about in a bit. But if you're here today and you have not given your life to Jesus Christ and made him your Lord and your Savior, I want to pray with you right now, and I want you to do that. Don't delay it. Don't even delay it one more second, because the devil is looking for every avenue to keep you from doing this. So you pray with me right now. Say, dear Jesus, I receive you as my Lord and as my Savior. I ask you to come into my heart and live in me. I receive forgiveness of all my sins, because I believe in my heart that you died for my sins and you were raised from the dead to show and prove that my sins have been forgiven. Thank you, dear Jesus, for it's in your name that I pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, the link has been posted. It's the Covenant Light Breakthrough Hour. That was the link that lady said I am part of. Click on it immediately after this broadcast. You won't be able to click on it right now. But immediately after the broadcast, you click on it and you will, it will take you into the WhatsApp group where you'll be getting these links directly. Also, the second one is the Covenant Light Global Online Church. If you do not attend the Covenant Light Church, but you want to keep hearing this depth, that's okay. You can click on that Covenant Light Global Online Church and be part of our online church that happens after most services during on Sunday at 3 p.m. And you get to hear me teach, and it's a whole new different ballgame entirely, complete with all the friends you will need to make. You know, we have strong friends on mission in that global online church. So click on those two links immediately after this meeting is over. Don't exit immediately. Just go to it and click on it and join in. Hallelujah. Lastly, let's receive our offerings as our custom is. The links, the instructions as to how to give will be posted. Father, in the name of Jesus, I ask that you would lead your people in how they should respond to you in their seeds this morning. And I thank you for that. And I pray that everyone who is giving this morning, that we will receive multiplied returns on our seed, and that you will use this seed to spread the word and help us reach more places and more people in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. All right. So wherever you are giving from Uganda, the line to give into is there. If you are giving from Kenya, the shillings account is there. If you are giving from outside any of these places, if you are giving in Nigeria, the account, Naira account is there. If you are giving from any of the other places in the world, the dollar account is there for you. So just give as you are led by the Spirit. Hallelujah. Thank you so much for joining in today. I look forward to have you join me again tomorrow. We're going to continue. And I'm telling you, every time we have this, it becomes stronger and stronger. Today was stronger. Tomorrow will be stronger. Till then, remember, you are loved by God and it's unconditional. Do have a wonderful, wonderful day today in Jesus' name. Amen.